1 minute to go. So hope all, I think I request all everyone to be go on mute, and we will try to provide the platform to the resource person, and I'm trying to organize this kind of an event in future also. Good morning, good morning sir, good morning sir.
Good morning all of you.
Yeah.
Good morning Murgesh.
Yeah, good morning sir.
Morning Professor Ganpati. Surprise for me to be
Good morning, good morning Sachin, good morning.
Chidu, good morning.
Chidanand.
Good morning Sachin sir.
Yes, good morning Mirandra.
Good morning sir. Hope we are not disturbing you too early in the morning. You know?
No, no other option.
Well, I can understand that night.
Okay. It's fine, it's fine. It's not an issue.
Thank you everyone for joining now without wasting much of time. I request the principal of BLD A.S. Patil College of Commerce, Sri V.S. Pagli sir, to kindly welcome the gathering. And this is one of the first in kind of international webinar which we have holded in the area of research. So over to Dr. Professor V.S. Pagli sir to welcome the gathering.
Good morning, everybody. North Karnataka, India, one of the unique association, BLD Association, ASP College of Commerce, is holding the international webinar under the IQAC. And today, on this occasion, I would like to welcome today's guest speaker and also the resource person, Dr. Sachin Kamble, Professor of Strategy, EDHEC Business School, LLM Finance, on behalf of A.S. Patil family. I wholeheartedly welcome to you, sir. And secondly, today's international webinar, president of the function, Dr. R.V. Kulkarni, the Chief Administrative Officer, BLD Association, Vijaypur. So, on behalf of A.S. Patil College of Commerce and all the stakeholders, I wholeheartedly welcome the today's president, sir. And another, the moderator of the events, Dr. M.R. Sholapur, the former faculty of Karnataka University, Dharwad, and also the director for Siddhganga Institute of Technology, Tumkur. Sir, I and ASP College of Commerce family wholeheartedly welcome you, sir. And today's function participants, the teaching fraternity, and research scholars are with us, ASP Commerce College, with heartily welcomes to you all, sir. And also the other stakeholders and assistants and organizers of this international webinar are assisting. And welcome once again, sir.
Thank you very much, Bali sir, for welcoming the gathering. And let me take this opportunity to introduce today the resource person as well as moderator of this event. Firstly, I would like to introduce Dr. Sachin sir. Dr. Sachin sir is a professor of strategy, operations and supply chain management at EDHEC Business School, Lille, France. He holds a PhD in a management and MBA in operations and a bachelor's degree in mechanical engineering. Before joining EDHEC France, sir worked with the National Institute of Industrial Engineering, Mumbai, NITI. And Dr. Sachin sir, teaching and research interest includes operations management, supply chain, big data analysis, Industry 4.0, and even digital transformation, to some extent even technology adoption also. He is more than, he has authored more than 50 publications, authored and co-authored, in a refereed international journals, and include high impact journals such as International Journals of Production Economics, International Journal of Production Research, Computers in Industry, International Journal of Information Management and Process Safety and Environment. Dr. Sachin sir has done more than 25 consultancy assignments for leading manufacturing and service organizations representing different sectors such as cement industry, oil refinery, fertilizer, seaports, textile, tires and pharmaceuticals. He has also designed and executed various executive development programs for senior level executives in the area of operations, supply chain management. Sachin sir has a highly acknowledged person in the field of research and loves to conduct research methodology workshop for students and young academics. Now, he has got very good and outstanding publications. I would like to read some of the main academic publications which Sachin sir has did. Technological Forecasting and Social Change 2021, International Journal of Production Economics 2020, Computers and Operations Research, International Journal of Production and Research, Journal of Cleaner Production, Management of Environment Quality and International Journal, Journal of Retailing and Consumer Service, Technology in Society, International Journal of Healthcare Management, International Journal of Productivity and Quality Management, International Journal of Logistics Research and Applications, Benchmarking and International Journal, International Journal of Managing Projects and Business, International Journal of Productivity and Performance Management, Process Safety and Environment Protection in Computers. Now, if I start going on reading, there will be, it's a countless, contribution has been made by Dr. Sachin sir to the academics and to the industry, and as well, even his greatest contribution for his research scholars too. And Sachin sir was my PhD guide when he was there in the National Institute of Industrial Engineering, and we have learned a lot from Dr. Sachin sir, not only me, even in entire my batch also. With this brief introduction, I welcome Dr. Sachin sir to this August gathering. Welcome, sir. Now, I would like to take this one more opportunity to welcome today's the moderator of this event, Dr. M.R. Solapur. Dr. M.R. Solapur, I feel very proud because Dr. M.R. Solapur, sir, belongs to my own institute, and he is alumni of BLE S. Patil College of Commerce. Firstly, I would like to tell Dr. M.R. Solapur, sir, is the director of Postgraduate Department of Management Studies and Research Centers, SIT Tumkur, Karnataka. He has more than 30 years of teaching experience at the collegiate and postgraduate levels, including Karnataka University, Dharwad, and even Marshall University, United States of America. Sir completed his basic schooling and college in the Karnataka, and he was one of the outstanding students during his academics. He stood first class distinction even in the college, school, and sir has obtained a Bachelor of Commerce in first class with distinction from A.S. Patil College of Commerce in Vijaypur, secured 8th rank to the Karnataka University, Dharwad. He holds first-class distinction in MCOM and MBA and secured second rank to the Karnataka University, Dharwad, India. Dr. M.R. Solapur, sir, did his PhD in finance and banking from Karnataka University, Dharwad, under the guidance of Dr. S.S. Hugar. He is also a law graduate from University of Mysore. And to talk to you about the research of Dr. M.R. Solapur, sir, has published near 40 research papers, 5 books, completed 3 funded research projects, and he has so far guided 6 PhDs and 2 MPhils in the area of banking and finance. He is actively participating in national and international seminars. He is also one of the editorial board of 2 management journals, and sir visited twice in a faculty exchange program USA during 2006-2008. His first visit was a presentation of papers in international business and economics research conference that won him in Clute University of Business Economics Research, USA. Now, the second visit to USA was his invention, Marshall Nestle, as a visiting professor of finance. Dr. M.R. Srolaprasad has sat on various committees on constituted for framing statutes, curriculum, designing a syllabi, revision of, and various labels. And one thing I would like to tell, Dr. M.R. Srolaprasad is also one of the guiding force for VLDS, E.S. Patil College of Commerce, and his contribution to the college and to the research and to the academics is enormous. So with this brief introduction, I would like to request, I'd like to introduce Dr. M.R. Srolaprasad to this August gathering. Sir, please welcome to this August gathering, Srolaprasad, sir. Now, without taking much of time, I would like to request Dr. Sachin, sir, to go ahead with the technical session, because it is one of the most, to tell you very frankly, sir, it is one of the most awaiting webinar for us. After so many long time, sir, there are so many research scholars, so many faculties, and there are so many people who have requested us to kindly save your, you know, this entire webinar, which they can refer in future, sir. So over to Dr. Sachin, sir.
Okay, thank you, Murgesh, once again. Thank you, Vilas Bagli, sir, the principal of his college, and also Professor M.R. Srolapure, who is present over here. It's good to be, like, say, among our own people, because I am basically from Belgaum, and then, like, say, I have been visiting this institute since long, maybe since 1999 I have been visiting. And as such, like, say, there hasn't been an emotional connect between the people working over there and me. So, as Murgesh said, that okay, I always enjoy taking these research methodology workshops, because it's basically a platform for me to come closer to the new researcher, younger generation. And the main objective of me conducting these workshops is not to teach, but to motivate and to encourage. Okay, it's basically to remove the fear of statistics, like, say, which most of the researchers they have in their mind. And when I conduct such type of webinars or the FDPs, that's on the research methodology, I don't use any PPTs. Okay, it's going to be purely interactive. And it's because, like, say, I just don't want to structure the flow. And because research is something, like, say, which should evolve and which should be shared with others. And for that, it requires a lot of interactions to go in. And with these interactions provides the opportunity for connecting the discussions to your own area of research and the present issues and problems that you would be facing in your research at present. So it would be pleasure like to understand if in case if you have any issues, if you are facing any problems in line with what we are discussing now. So you are interested and you are most welcome to post your questions to me, and I'll be very much happy to answer them. Now, as such, like, say, this session today is focused on, or is titled as, statistical methods in research. Okay, so I'll be focusing more on the different statistical tools and techniques, and not on, like, say, how to frame a research problem or how to conduct a review of literature. So that's not the focus of this workshop. So maybe sometime in future, we may meet separately for those topics. Okay, so today it's going to be purely on, like, how we can best understand statistics and link it to social science research. Okay, so when I say social science research, I'm focusing on some specific streams in terms of, like, say, commerce or maybe management. Okay, and but then the discussion is going to be very generic in nature, and anyone, like, say, working in these areas, like in the field of commerce and management, and also the allied subjects, they will find this today's session very interesting and interactive. So with this brief, I'll start with the discussions. Okay, so pay attention. If any questions, you can put in the chat and we can take it for discussion. So hope you are able to see the screen. Okay. So we start with our discussion. And to start with, what we'll do is that, like, say, we'll start with a few research objectives. Okay, so assuming that you have already formed the research objectives for your study. Because when you talk about your research methods, the research method has to be linked to your research, the statistical methods has to be linked to your research objectives. Now, the research objectives is going to be, coming from your review of literature, which already you would have conducted. Okay, and this basically it's the gaps what you have identified from the research. Now let's take a very simple example for today's class. So a very simple example, which everyone can understand, right? And this will take it from the perspective of a marketing researcher, okay, or a research scholar who is doing his research in marketing area. But then, as I told you, this can be very much generalized for any other area, okay? So I'll just write down some research objectives over here to begin with. So let's say that we have a researcher and who is interested to do a research on, the consumer behavior, and the product of interest to him is laptop. Okay, so I have taken laptop so that, because everyone is owning a laptop or is using a laptop, and he specifically understands the various features that goes into a laptop. Okay, so that's the reason, why I have taken this particular example. Now, as this is a product focused research, because it's the laptop product, the researcher wants to study a few aspects with regards to the consumer behavior. Okay, so the first aspect is that he wants to know, what are the features, that are considered by a consumer while he is going to purchase a laptop. What are the features a consumer looks into while he is going to purchase a laptop? And now he, as such, he has gone through the different research papers, and then he has found that there are many factors, but then as such, the factors price, the processing speed, the memory size, but then he finds that this is all scattered throughout the research papers or the different sources, internet and all secondary sources, published reports on the internet. Okay, so it is all scattered. As such, not many studies has been conducted in this particular domain. Okay, so this is just I'm just trying to build a scenario for you. Okay, so the scenario is that it is one of the first kind of research in this particular field. Okay, and his main intention is to study the consumer behavior. And when I talk about consumer behavior, it's about, he wants to know what are the factors or the features a consumer is going to look at while purchasing a laptop. So that's the first particular objective he's looking at. So he at present, he does not know which are the factors. So he would like to explore it. Okay, to explore factors considered or while considered for purchase of a laptop. So that is the first objective. Okay, because the research gap says that it is not much known. Okay, and second, he wants to identify, once the factors are explored, okay, explored in the sense, identified. So then second step or the second objective he wants to know is that to identify the most important factors. Okay, so there is a difference over here in these two objectives. The first objective is to explore, right? To identify. Because these factors are not known. So it is he knows a few factors, price, okay, the screen size and so on. But then once that is known, okay, that's basically more about exploring, identifying. But then The second is that to identify the most important factors. So like say from the first objective, we come to know that there are like say 15 factors. But then out of these 15 factors, which are the most important one or the most preferred factors? Okay, that is second objective. Now, the third objective is, okay, the third objective he wants to know, okay, about like say the satisfaction level of using a laptop, right? So to measure the satisfaction level on use of laptop. Okay, and then the fourth one is, I'm just going to write some objectives so that I can use these objectives to explain you the research through the different statistical techniques that's going to be used. Okay, so the third objective is to measure the satisfaction level on use of laptop. And then also he wants to study the brands. Okay, so brands is basically he wants to study most preferred brands. Okay, so right now we'll just restrict it to these four objectives, and later on if required we can add a few more objectives to see how it proceeds further. Now let's focus on the first objective and see how we can be using statistics over here. Now it is important for us to understand that there are going to be some research designs which you would be using, okay, while you want to achieve your objectives. So when you achieve, when you want to achieve your objectives, in the sense like say basically you should be requiring some information to get the details about your research objectives, in the sense like say to explore factors. Now the question is that say like how you're going to explore these factors, right? How you're going to explore these factors and what type of statistics goes into it. But then before that we have to understand what type of research design you'd be following for this first research objective. So now what I'll going to do is like say I'll just try to think as a researcher, right, and see like how I can explore the factors. Now the first point over here is that it's about exploration. It means that it's not known to me yet. Okay, it's not known to me yet. So how do I come to know about this? Okay, so I will come to know about this from the previous studies, there's review of literature, right? I can come to know about this by talking to the customers who have already purchased a laptop. I can come to know about this from, like, say, the company reports or some reports on the internet. I can come to know about this, like, say, from the people who are planning to purchase a laptop. Right? So it's about the exploration. And when I'm going to explore, okay, so my study is going to take the exploratory nature. Okay, so here the first type of research design is going to be of exploratory kind. So it's basically called as the exploratory research, because you are exploring. And over here it is basically you are exploring it from some secondary sources, okay, or you're going to explore it through interaction. Here you are not going to use survey. Why you can't use a survey is that, like say, when you're going to conduct a survey, you'll be requiring to have a questionnaire, okay, and you can't use a questionnaire over here because you don't know the factors. Okay, if you know the factors, in that case you would have added those factors in the questionnaire and then asked the respondents to tick the factors which is more important for them or which they consider while purchasing the laptop. But then this is not my objective, right? That becomes my second objective, to identify the most important factors. That will be coming later. Questionnaire, you can say, okay sir, we can use a question within, like say in the questionnaire I can add list down okay, the most important factors, and they just keep it open-ended, right? But then second, the same thing is like, say more about interaction. You are asking someone to interact, but then in this case through a questionnaire. But then the question is open-ended. There are no options you are giving. So it's more like an interaction with the use of questionnaire. Okay. So whenever it's going to be exploratory studies, you can refer to the published sources, which is referred to as here in this case as secondary sources, or you can also use the primary source, but then that's going to be more of an interaction with the respondents. Okay, so these respondents could be the industry people, these respondents could be the existing customers, these respondents could be the future potential customers. Now, over here, I go with the exploratory study and I conduct some interviews, I conduct some interactions, I refer some journals, and from there I come to know about the factors. Okay. To make it simple, what I can say is that I will just write a few factors. I'll write some factors which a customer usually considers for purchasing a laptop. And as I told you, it is explored now. Okay, so these are my findings coming from the interactions and secondary sources. And this is like, say, the price. Okay, the processing speed. The screen size, the weight of the laptop, the battery life or the size, then and say keypad lights. Okay, then I can say processing speed is returned, then memory. Then I want to have it metallic finish. Okay, so warranty. And then is AMC, the annual maintenance cost. Then I have like, say, on-site support service. Okay, and 12 is remote support service. Okay, so now it is just 12 what I have written, but when in reality you're going to conduct this, okay, this study for the first objective, it may happen that it may not be restricted to 12, it might be like, say, some 25 to 30 variables. Now I'm calling this as the variables. Why? Because, okay, the importance that's going to be attached by the customer on these factors are going to be differing. It's not going to be the same. Okay, so in what happens in research is that, say, when we're going to deal with so many large number of features, okay, in the past I had done one workshop and we tried to identify the factors which are considered by the customers while purchasing a four-wheeler, and it was an open discussion session, it was face to face, and we had one full day for that, right? And to a surprise, like, say, we had identified something like 86 factors or the features, okay, which they considered, the customers considered to be important for purchasing a car, a four-wheeler. So whenever in research we're dealing with such type of complexities, because it's going to be difficult for us to, like, say, comment on each and every of these particular features. Now, the next question would be, like, say, is it possible to group these variables or these features, okay, and like, say, prepare an abstract of this? So is it possible to see some commonality between these 12 variables? Okay, like, say, I'm looking at the price, I'm looking at the warranty, and I'm looking at the AMC. So is it that somehow I can link this? Okay, so is it that I can club these three, price, warranty, and AMC, and then say, okay, when a customer is looking for these three aspects, okay, so he's basically looking for something called as economy. Okay, just a thought, like, say, which means that price, a customer is looking for or giving importance for price, AMC, and warranty. Is it that he is looking for economy as a package? Okay, so when I talk about the processing speed, when I talk about the memory, okay, so these two aspects. So can I club these two and then say that, okay, he is looking at the technical aspects? Okay, but then this is, let's say, not at present my objective, because the objective what I'm talking about was to explore the factors. And here in this case, I have explored the factors. I have explored 12 factors. Okay, so how I have done this? I have done it through the interaction. So my first objective is actually achieved. Okay, so this was not my objective. My objective was to list down these factors, explore the factors. That's done, right? So then in this particular case, for the first objective, we adopted an exploratory research design from secondary sources, and through the interactions, we have achieved our objective. Now this is done, okay? Now we move on to the second objective. The second objective over here is to identify the most important factors. Now for that, I would like to go a step forward, right? Because here in this case, if you see, it is just explode, but then I cannot assign the importance. Now, if at all I have to assign the importance, I have to ask the next question. And what is that next question? That next question is going to be like, I have to ask the customers about how much importance they are going to attach, okay, on each of these factors. So for that, I'll be required to go to the customers and ask using a rating scale. So I'll use a rating scale from 1 to 5, and I'll ask, coming to price, okay, when you're purchasing a laptop, or when you have already purchased a laptop, okay, so it could be a existing customer who have already purchased the laptop, or it could be the potential customer who would be purchasing the laptop maybe in the near future. So when I'm going to ask him, I will ask, like, say, in your already purchased decision, or when you're going to purchase it in future, how much you think would be the importance you'd be attaching to price. So here I will be saying very high, okay, and here I'll be saying not at all, okay, or very low. So here we have a scale which is going to actually measure the importance level is going to attach to price. Likewise, I have to attach it for the second variable, the third variable, fourth variable, fifth variable, sixth, seventh, eighth, ninth, 10th, 11th, 12th. So I have to use a scale for all these variables, right? Now, when I have prepared this scale, so it means that, like, say, now I have to take this scale to the customers and I have to ask their response. Okay. Now, my study is going to be more meaningful and more accurate if, in case, if I'm going to ask these questions to more number of customers or more number of respondents. Okay, so there are some rules available for us, like, say, on how we can average the sample size. But if you're doing a research, okay, so I'll just give a rule of thumb, like, say, something around 300, okay, as the sample size would be a good thing when you're going to do it for a research paper. And when it's going to be for your thesis, okay, something in the range of 500 to 800 would be a good sample size. So now, proceeding further, I plan to do this survey, okay, because this is just for this illustration purpose, for this workshop purpose. I plan to do this survey on 25 respondents. Okay, I plan to do this survey on 25 respondents. So it means that when I have to reach 25 respondents, when I go to them, one thing is that I can go personally, I can meet them, and I can take the responses on these particular skills. But as such, I told you, that more number of respondents, it is going to be much more better for me. So for me to reach more number of respondents, just going and meeting each and every one is not going to be, like say, feasible. It's going to, like say, incur cost, as well as it is going to take a lot of time. It is going to consume time. So I decide that, okay, let me type this, okay, and send it across with the instructions, like how he has to fill this sheet. So here, basically, I'll be going for a survey. And a survey is going to use a questionnaire. And because the questionnaire content is known to me in advance, I know these 12 variables, okay? And I know what is to be measured and how it is to be measured. So for me to develop a questionnaire is going to be easy. In the previous case, it was not easy for me to develop the questionnaire because I was not knowing these 12 factors, right? So now you are coming to a situation wherein, like say, you are knowing the factors. And that's why, like say, when it comes to the second research objective, okay, to identify the most important factors or the features considered while purchasing a laptop, it has to have a different research design, because you have seen the change now, right? In the first case, we have interacted. In the second case, we are now dispatching the questionnaires. And therefore, whenever you are going to conduct a survey, the research design is going to be changing, and this research design is now referred to as your descriptive research design. So in descriptive, you basically are going to use a survey sheet or a questionnaire. And why it is called descriptive is because you are describing how these 25 respondents are going to respond to these variables. So basically, it's the description of these 25 respondents on these variables. Okay, so this is referred to as the descriptive research design. There's one more research design. I'll just cover that also now itself. And that is causal research design. Okay, in some Indian textbooks on research methodology, there is a misprint in this name of this research design. Okay, so instead of causal, somewhere in some research textbooks, you'll find that as causal. Okay, so this is not causal, it is causal, cause and effect. Okay, so this is also similar to your descriptive research design with only small change. Okay, so here also you're going to use survey, here also you're going to have the questionnaire. Okay, but then like say in this questionnaire, if you have two questions, question number one and question number two, so I write it over here, like say, which brand you own. Okay, I give the options, like say HP, I say Dell, I say LG, okay, I say larger ABC, okay, some laptop brands. And second question is your gender, so I give the option male, I give the option as female. Now, the researcher wants to know whether the brand, the customer.
Okay, I think we are going to get back, and the resource person is back with us. Apology for the inconvenience caused, and sir, you are back online, and thank you for beginning.
Chidu, can you tell me, like say, where I was left, like say, which point?
Soon after
the last point, the factors which we were, you know, what are the second point which we were discussing about important factors?
Yeah, okay. Second important factors. Yeah.
Okay, so sorry, the participants, because I had kept my mobile on mute, and then Murkesh was trying to reach me, but then I'll see to it that now I don't keep my mobile on mute. Okay,
Fine, sir. We can share your screen and we can resume back.
Okay, so Murgesh, are you on mic?
Yeah, sir.
Okay, just to let me know, like, say where it got disconnected exactly. So we wrote those 11 factors.
11 factors, and you spoke about what are the important factors.
Okay, did we enter spaces?
No, sir.
Okay. Okay, so I'll just continue from where we had left. So I'll just try to again reproduce this price. Okay, so we have identified those important factors. So we had those 11 factors. Now we go back and to, like, say, understand, like, say, how do we arrive at how these are the important factors? So which statistical tools I'd be willing to use for that. Now, as I told you, like, say, the research design. Just a minute. Okay, so now we had written those 11 factors. Now I would like you to introduce to you the SPSS, and then let's see, like, say, how we can identify which are the important factors. So actually, this is what I had finished now during when the disconnection was lost, but I'm sorry I couldn't.
Hello, sir. Sachin, sir. Sir, please mute yourself, sir. Sir, unmute yourself, sir.
Yeah, are you able to listen to me now?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So now I'm just reconnecting that. So as I told, like, say, in the previous discussion where we got disconnected, so we had price, we had processing speed, we had the screen size, the weight, the battery, right? The keypad lights, the memory, and so on. So we had identified those factors. Now for me to take it forward, I'll be required to conduct a survey. So why survey is because, like, say, here, I want to know the importance. And I am, like, focusing on just 25 respondents, but in reality, like, say, it should be a greater size of sample, okay, wherein, like, say, the results are going to be more accurate if you're going to have higher sample size. Now, for a demo purpose for today's class, we'll just focus on 25 respondents so that we can have it in more like an workshop mode. The data when collected is going to look like this. Okay, so when it's going to be in Excel, so the data when it's going to be collected is going to be looking like this. Like, so we have the rows. So we have respondent one, we have the respondent two, we have the respondent three, we have the respondent four, and so on. Now, here we are going to have the variable one, which is the price. Then we're going to have the variable two, that is the processing speed, and so on. The respondent one is going to, like, say, give his rating on the scale of 1 to 5. So he says that, okay, for me price is very important, so I'm going to give a rating of 4. The respondent one says that on the processing speed, okay, it is not that very much important, I'm going to give it a importance of just 2. And likewise on the screen size, okay, he says that it is not important, so it's going to give just an importance value of 1. And, like, say, battery is very important, so he'll say it's highest important for me, so it's going to be 5. Likewise, respondent 2, like, he is going to give his own set of responses depending upon his importance is going to attach to these variables. Likewise for R3, so it is, like, say, 3, 2, 1, 1, and so on. So we are going to collect, like, say, the responses from the respondents, and if in case your sample size is 25, you're going to have 25 responses on these various variables. Okay, so now once that is done, I'll be required to analyze it. And for the analyst purpose, I will go on to the Spaces. So I just kept a file open over here on Spaces. So it's a new file. Now here, what I do is that in Spaces, it's just like Excel, the one which I showed to you. Here we're going to have two views, the data view and the variable view, the data view and the variable view. So these two views we are going to have, right? Now your data view is just like your Excel, wherein, like, say, you have the respondents here, like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, so on, and you have the variables over here. But then, like in Excel, we just can't type it over here, the column headings. For that, we are required to come to the variable view. Now here I am going to type the variables. Like, say, maybe create the variables. So this is going to take some time. I'll just limit myself to some 4 or 5 variables to save time. So I'm going to type it, like, it's the price, it's the screen size, okay? So it will not take space. Then it's going to be the AMC, it's going to be the other ones, just a minute, the weight, okay, then we have the memory, and we have the, just type it over here, AMC.
Sir, I cannot able to see the screen of the Spaces.
Not seeing the screen of F Spaces?
Yes, sir.
You can see it now?
Yes, yeah. Thank you so much.
So just if you are not seeing anything visual, like, and so you have to instruct me, okay? So yes. Someone should come online and then tell me quickly so that it is not lost in the process. Don't wait. Okay. So I've just, like, say, typed a few things over here. On site and remote. So we don't make any changes over here. So as I told you, like, say, I was telling about SPSS. So SPSS is going to have two views. It's going to have a data view and it's going to have a variable view. So here we are going to put in this, create this particular variables. And then in the data view, you will find that it is getting created. Okay, so like this. So once it is done, our next job is to, like, run the analysis, right? So now in the process, like, say, when we had launched the disconnection, I had prepared this entire slide, this sheet in SPSS, and I had run the analysis. So what I'll do is that I'll just go on to that particular sheet in SPSS and directly show to you that same slide. That is going to save our time. I'm again sharing this, and now coming to the SPSS sheet. Can you see this sheet?
No, sir, we can't see the screen.
Just a minute. Okay. Just see now?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Okay, so here, there is an advancement. What we have done is that I have put in some data. And this data you can see is that, like, say, it is for the 25 respondents. It's clear? So as I told you, I'll just brief you once again. I go to the variable view in SPSS. I type all the variables. Don't make any changes over here. We'll just keep it as it is. Okay. For time being, we'll not look into the other aspects. So whenever you're going to log into SPSS, okay, so you're going to have the data view and we're going to have the variable view. So now in the data view, we have entered the data. That's nothing but the responses captured from the survey. And then I am going to now run the analysis. Now to run the analysis, you'll see that over here on the top, we have this toolkit, okay, the menu analyze. So within that, you have all the SPSS tools. Now I come to the dimension reduction and I click the factor because I am running the factor analysis. Okay, but then is it that, like, say, I should be going for the factor analysis? Is that my intention? If you see the second objective was to identify the most important variables. Now that most important variables, I can also get it through the mean values, right? So what I'll do is that I'll just go with the basic tool, that is the mean, because my objective is very clear. My objective is to identify the most important variables. So I come to analyze and I come to distribute statistics and I click the descriptives, okay? And over here, if you see that this is what you're going to get, this small window is going to pop up, right? So are you seeing this window, right? The descriptives window?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So now over here,
yes.
So you have to select the variables from this window and push it to this window. And only on those variables, the test will be conducted. So for me, all these variables are important. So what I do is that I just push it over here, the variable view. And I go to the options. And in the options, I select just the mean at present, okay, to make it more simple. And I click the descending means. So it means, like, the variables which has the mean value highest, that will be on the top and it will be projected to us in the descending order. So I just say continue and I'm going to run this test. I just say it as okay. Okay, so now the results are out, and again, because that is going to be open in a different window, so I'll just try to show it to you and just tell me whether you can see this window. Are you seeing this result window?
No.
Yes, sir. Yes, yes, sir.
Okay, so that's good. Okay, so it's open in different window, but then luckily there's no need to again stop the sharing and again move on to the next window to be shared. So
sir,
you can see the values.
This will open automatically.
So okay. So what you do is that once you go analyze and then you say the mean, descriptive statistics and the descriptives, and you select the mean. Okay. Okay. So automatically this window will open. And over here in this window, you have the values. So what you find from here is that price is the most important, followed by warranty, and that is purely we are talking on the mean values. Higher the mean, it is good, because we know that the scale is from 1 to 5. 1 is not at all important, and 5 is highly important. So that is the rule we are going to follow. So 4.12 is more on the higher side, so it is much important for us. So it's like, say, based on this, we are going to get the importance of this particular variables. That is, I can say now that fine, these are the variables which are important, and the degree of importance for each of the variables is expressed in terms of the mean values. Now, so we have got our objectives. The first objective was to explore. We explored the variables. Second objective was to identify the most important variables. Yeah, so we have achieved it. Okay, but then I would like to give something more. Okay, I would like to say, okay, now these are 12 variables which we have taken, right? So assuming that if there are 35 variables which have been identified in the first objective, then it becomes difficult and it becomes very clumsy, right, for me to interpret. So is it possible for me to add in some convenience and like say clarity on this particular analysis? So there is one analysis called as factor analysis. Okay, now what is this factor analysis? Now in factor analysis, what I do is that I go to analyze and I do a factor analysis. I'll run the factor analysis and they'll tell you about, like say, what is the importance of this factor analysis. Now I'm going to dimension reduction and I'm clicking it as factor. Right? I again select all these factors because it's coming by default. So I select all the factors because I want to run this factor analysis on all these 11 variables. I don't make any changes over here. I keep it default. I don't make any changes over here. I keep it default. I don't make any changes over here. I keep it default. So there's nothing to worry over here. You just take all the default settings and then say OK. So you can see the screen now, a new result window.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
OK. So now you have to come to this one, the rotated component matrix. Right? Now in the rotated component matrix, I will take a snapshot of this because I have to close this window and move on to the PPT. So I'll just take a snapshot so that I remember these values. Now, what is important is that you have to see the price, right? So price, you see the highest value. It has to be more than 0.56. So it is coming as 0.856. And it is coming in the third component, right? Weight is coming in the first component, 0.966 at the highest value. The screen size is coming in the first component. The battery is coming in the second component. So likewise, we have to see which of these variables is lying in which of the component. Now, how to interpret this and how to come up with the conclusion, I'll just tell you about that. So for that, I'll be again stopping the screen share and I'll be just moving temporarily to the PPT. So I'll share the PPT screen. Okay, so it is seen now, right? The PPT is seen, Murgesh?
Yes, now it's there, sir.
Okay, so now here what happens is that, like say, those three components were there. I'll just talk it as like say three buckets. Yeah, and I told you like say these buckets, like say 1, 2, and 3. So we can call it as component 1, 2, and 3, or we can call it as dimension 1, 2, and 3. So these three buckets, what I can do is that I can just go on adding those variables in these buckets depending upon their values. So as I told you, price was having the highest value of 0.856 in the component 3. So I add price over here. Then the weight was having the highest value of 0.966 in component 1. So I just add it as weight over here. So likewise, I just go on adding. So screen size is coming over here. Then I have battery is coming over here. Then I just go on classifying it or just adding it. Okay. So keypad is over here. Memory is over here. Then metallic is over here. And then AMC is coming over here, and warranty is coming over here, and okay, so this is what we have got, right? So now the next step is that you have to give a name to this component or this dimension. The researcher has to give it because he is the person, the best person to arrive at a name. So what I can see is that these variables, weight, screen, keypad, metallic body and all, that basically explains the style, right? Battery and the memory and the processing speed and all, if it is going to be coming over here, I will say that these are the technical features or technical factors. And over here, price, aims and warranties coming together. So I'll say that it is as the economy factor. So basically what is happening is that, like say, now these 12 features what I had, that has been reduced into these three main dimensions. And that is what is the outcome coming from the factor analysis. Okay. So this particular information, so if you just see the objectives, right? The first objective was to explore the factors. Second objective was to identify the important factors. Now this identification was done based on the mean values. Okay, the ranking of these factors was done using the mean values. So from there we come to know about the importance of each of these factors. In exploring factors, we explored 12 factors, right? And then further we reduce it to three dimensions. So see, for the first objective, how I could add in more inputs, or I can give more additional supporting findings to make it more clear, to make it more meaningful, to make it more easy for us to understand. If I just stick on to the previous thing, like say those are the 12 factors we had and each factor had something, okay, importance, mean values, it is difficult, right? So every time talking to the practitioner or the company based on my findings that there are 12 factors, price, AMC, warranty, battery, instead of that, I can just say that, okay, the customer looks for style, the customer looks for technicality, the customer looks for economy. That is going to be more meaningful for me to present my findings to the audience. Okay, the audience in this case could be the other researchers, or the audience could be, like say, the industry practitioners. Now, next, as we have just seen these two things, next I would like to move on and strengthen our understanding on the different statistical tools. Like say in the first case, like say for the second objective, we used the means. But then why means? Why can't I use a chi-square over there? Or why can't I use an ANOVA over there? Or why can't I use a regression over there? Okay, so that was not answered by me. I just said, okay, we'll use the mean because that is going to give me the results, that the most important factors. But now I want to, like say, develop an understanding of statistical research and how that can be linked to the research objectives. But then more specifically, I want to gain the knowledge on which tools when to be used. So that is very important. Okay. So now for that, what we'll do is that we'll just try to have more knowledge on the variables. Okay. And here, when it comes to the statistics, the variables can be of two types. Okay. The variables can be qualitative and the variables can be quantitative, right? So in the qualitative, like say I give the example how we can distinguish between a qualitative variable and the quantitative variable. Like say, for example, gender. So when I'm going to ask any question in the questionnaire, on gender. So this is basically I am focusing more on when we are going to conduct the survey, okay, not interactions, because statistics is going to be only applied on when we are going to conduct the survey. That is, statistics will be used for the descriptive type of research design and the causal type of research design. Okay, so here, coming to the gender. So gender, I can give two options because I know these two options, male and then the female. Now here, the respondent is going to just tick one of the options. If he's male, he's going to tick male. If he's female, if she is female, she is going to tick female. This is one of the examples. Okay. Now, which is your most preferred brand? I know the name of the brand. Okay. Like say, I talk about HP. I talk about Dell. Okay. I talk about Samsung. Okay. I talk about like say MSP. Okay. So these are the four and fifth is, I'll just keep it as others. Now here again, you can see is that the respondent is going to tick the brand whichever he owns. So again, he can tick. Okay, if I have a Dell, I'm going to tick Dell. So this is qualitative. Okay. And instead of confusing ourselves by using the qualitative, what I can say is that I'll make it more easy for you. Instead of qualitative, what we do is that we'll make it as categorical. We'll call it as categorical in our workshop or this discussion. Why categorical? Because I am providing you the options, the categories from where you will just be required to place a tick mark. Okay, so I'll just give one more example, age group. Okay, so one, I give the first category less than 18. Second category, I give it as from 18 to 25. Third category, I give it from 25 to 40. Fourth category, I give it is from 40 years and above. So whenever I'm going to provide you the categories and you will be required to just tick mark one of the option applicable to you, that we're going to refer it as to be the categorical variables. Now coming to the quantitative part. Here, I am not giving you the categories. Okay, here I'll be using a scale, or I'll be using an open-ended question for which the answer is going to be numerical. Okay, so basically instead of quantitative now, I'll call it as the numerical, because both these questions are going to catch a numerical value. Like in the previous example of the factors, we used one example, like say for price, I used a scale from 1 to 5. So now what was the respondent required to give as his response on this scale? It was, he has to give a numerical value, like say 3 or 2 or 1 or 4 or 5, depending upon the importance he attaches to the scale. So this is numerical value. So we are going to capture the numbers. So therefore, I'm calling it as now numerical. Now open-ended. Open-ended is like say I'm not giving him any scale. I just ask him a open-ended question. And that is like say, what is your age? I don't give any categories. I don't give any options. Like over here, I've given the categories. Here, I'm not going to give any categories. I just ask him, what is your age? He says, my age is 25 years. So again, you see that I got a number. Okay, so how many laptops do you own? How many laptops do you own? So again, I just keep it open-ended. But then he has to give me a number. He says 2 laptops. If he's not having any laptop, he will say it has equal to 0. So this is the main difference between the numerical and the categorical variable. Okay. Now, when it comes to the research, it is going to be your choice. Okay. That whether you're going to use the categorical variable or you're going to use the numerical variable. Sometimes there are no options available to you between these two choices, but then mostly, as far as possible, you try to make it numerical or keep it numerical. Like say, for example, age. Age, I can capture it categorical. I can also capture it as numerical, as just I shown you. What is your age? Keep it open-ended. What is your age? Select one out of these four categories, like less than 20, 22, 50, 52, 70, 70 and above. I have given the categories, you are going to select one. Whereas here, my age is 45, I'll just set it as 45 years. Now, why I'm saying is that you should keep it numerical because this is going to be more accurate. Whereas 45 over here is lying in between the second option. I'll be taking this if this option was given to me. But then it can be anything between 20 and 25. It's an interval. That is not going to be accurate. But over here, it's going to be more accurate. But then age is some sensitive information. Like say, many people would be not comfortable to give. Okay, so many people may leave it a blank. Whereas people would be comfortable to write the age over here. The other example could be your income. Okay, so income also I can make it categorical, I can make it numerical. So I can give the options like less than 1 lakh annual income, less than 1 lakh, 1 to 5 lakh, 5 to 10 lakh and 10 and above. Whereas here, I just keep it open-ended. What is your income? Okay, like say 6 lakhs, annual income is 6 lakhs. But then I'll be not comfortable with this, I'll be comfortable with this. Okay? So therefore, the choice is with you. As far as possible, you try to make it numerical. But then there are some questions like say gender. Gender can be only and always categorical. I can't make it numerical. Brand, the most preferred brand. So again, brand, it can be only categorical. It cannot be numerical. Okay, so now why is that, like I have placing the importance on this is that because the type of scale or the type of data, okay, or we call it as the scales, categorical and the numerical, because your entire statistics is going to be based on this. So now I'm just going to give you a table over here that will talk about, like say, which test to be used when. So this is, I'm just talking about the type of variable. Okay, so now say the variable is a categorical. And I'll give an example over here. Okay, an example, like say gender. Now when it's the gender, right? So then, I'll just clean. Then the test is, you have to use either percentage or frequency. Okay, so that is the test which is going to be available. For gender, you cannot calculate the mean. For gender, you cannot calculate the mean. For example, like say there are 10 students in a class. Okay, and I say one stands for male and two stands for female. And usually in Excel, when we are going to enter this data, we enter it as the code and we don't type male, female and so on. We just enter the codes, right? So say like say 10 students, so 1, 1, 1, 2, 2, 2, 2, 2, 1, 1. So we have 10 students, like so 5 of them are female and 5 of them are male. Okay, so now if I want to calculate the mean for this, so mean would be like say if I add all this, it will be 15. Okay, and 15 upon 10 would be what? 1.5. Now what do you interpret or how do you interpret this 1.5? So 1 stands for male and 2 stands for female. So 1.5 stands for what? In between male and female. So can I say the average gender of this class is 1.5? That is wrong. In this case, I am going to make a big or a huge mistake. Right? So therefore, when your data is categorical, you can't calculate mean. It is ruled out. Right? So what I'll do is that I will move on to the next type of data now. Okay, and I'll say that, okay, the data what I have with me is numerical. Okay, so this is C and this is N. And here I can take it as the age. So when it is numerical, you can straight away go with the mean. You can just go with the mean. Okay, then the next. The other possibilities. I have two variables and both are categorical. Like say, the first question is asking about the gender. What is the gender? The second question is talking about the brand. Okay, the second question is talking about your most preferred brand. So in that case, I give them 4 or 5 options of the brand. In gender, I have 2 options, and that is the male and the female. So you know now that by design, these are both the categorical variables. Now, when you want to, like say, understand the interaction between these two variables, so in that case, you are going to use chi-square. Okay, likewise, I am proceed further. I'll try the other combination. When I have both the variables which are numerical, like say, for example, I have age, okay, and I have the satisfaction on the brand. Okay, so age, I'm just keeping it open-ended. What is your age? It is numerical. I'm not giving him the interval. Okay, I'm not giving him the options. I'm not making it categorical. Age, I have taken it as the numerical variable. Satisfaction also, I'm giving in the options. Like, satisfaction also, I'm giving in the scale. Like 1 to 5. 1 stands for not at all satisfied, and 5 stands for highly satisfied. So it becomes a numerical. So both in this example are the numerical. So in such a case, I'll be using regression analysis. And then finally, is there anything missing out? Any other combination? Okay, I can have N and C. Like say, I can have gender, and I can have satisfaction. Okay, so in gender and satisfaction, what I can see over here is that this is categorical, male, female, and this is a scale what I've used, 1 to 5. So this becomes numerical. So in such type of case, because gender has only 2 options, male and female, I use 2 sample p test. Now there is one more possibility, n into c. I use profession, or sorry, I use the occupation. Now occupation is like say he is a businessman, or maybe he's a student, or she's a housewife, or he is a professional. Or a doctor, something like that. So the number of groups or the number of options is more than 2. So more than 2 options. And then I have satisfaction over here. Okay. So what you will find is that here in this case, the test I will be using is one-way ANOVA. Okay, so this is basically going to act as the toolkit for you. Okay, now in research, any type of statistics you can be performing with this particular knowledge. Now quickly what I'll do is that I'll just quickly show you the chi-square and whatever we can cover. Okay, so it's not difficult now, because SPS is just a procedure. Once you come to know about this basis, like which test to be used when, you can perform any test, because on Google you'll be finding the detailed steps on how to conduct this chi-square regression analysis, two sample t-test and ANOVA. So all the detailed steps will be available. Okay, for that there is not much of training required, but and still, because we have time with us, okay, I will show you how to do it on the SPSS. And it's not only SPSS, you can also perform all these tests, okay, which is written over here on Excel. Okay, so that also is possible. Now I stop the screen sharing and I move on to SPSS. Okay, are you seeing the screen?
Yes, sir.
Okay, take it. Okay, so now let's try to do chi-square. Okay, so I repeat, for chi-square, we will be required to have 2 variables. Okay, and both these variables have to be categorical. So when I want to investigate the categorical variables, I have to use chi-square. And I remember it's the gender I had used, and I had used the brand. Okay. Now, okay. So let me do it in a different way. Let's go back. This thing. If you just recollect the other objectives we had written. First objectives we have covered now. The third objective. Okay. The third objective was to know the brand preference. The third objective was to know the brand preference of the laptop. Okay, so this is what we had written. Now, what I do is that, like, say, make it more interesting and more meaningful. Okay, so what I'll do is that I'll just not focus on the most preferred brand. Okay. I will also link it to, like, say, whether this preference is same across the gender or it differs. So for that, I'll be requiring two questions. So question one would be, which is your most preferred brand? I give the options: HP, Dell, Samsung, and four, I just added over here as Zenith. The second question that I'll be required is, because I'll be requiring two variables, okay? So to know the brand preference, okay, and just not to know the brand preference, I'll making it more interesting across gender. So if you see this objective, you will find that in this objective we have two variables. One is the brand preference and the other one is the gender. So two variables means I have to have minimum two questions. So which is your most preferred brand? So I have one question over here, and second question is your gender. So whether you are a male or you are a female. So now you see, like, when I'm going to use these two questions in the questionnaire, both are categorical. And the respondent is just going to tick either this or this. Okay, so this becomes in nature categorical. Okay, so with this background, we go on to our spaces. So this is very important for us to understand, because your objectives, from the objectives, you will come to know about which are the variables involved. And now, as I told you, also to decide on how you're going to use or develop a questionnaire. So we require two questions. Okay, and this study design for the third objective is causal, cause and effect, because you have two variables. So now I stop sharing and I'll go to spaces with this background. I come to spaces. Okay, and I have added gender, because I told you in spaces, whenever you come, you have to have the data view and we have to have the variable view. So I have entered the data. Sorry, before entering the data, I come to variable view. I just typed gender, and here I'm going to type it as brand, which they own or which they plan to own. So if you see now.
Excuse me, sir.
Yeah.
Sir, in variable view, we have taken gender as numerical. Can you go to variable view?
Yeah. So if you go, if you come over here, okay. So there is no need for you to change any of this. Okay, make any of these default changes. You just can continue as it is, because more than the spaces, now you are aware that, okay, this data, this type of data is what? Categorical.
Okay? But while providing results, won't it consider it as numerical?
No. It will not, because the test what you're going to conduct, okay? Your test is based on the toolkit what I've provided. Is that fine?
Okay, sir.
Okay. So therefore, you don't worry much about these things. Okay, that will not have any effect on your output. So coming over, so therefore, I have not focused on this part. Okay, but then as you know that, okay, this is categorical, means it is nominal, or sorry, ordinal or nominal. It's both either of these. So you can select. So okay, so nominal in the sense over here, gender is nominal, and then brand also is nominal. So basically categorical. Okay. But then this all, price, weight and all, these were all the scales which we had used. So if you want, you can make the changes, but it is not required. So don't spend time on that. Okay. So coming over here now, I'll just randomly put the values, because now we know one is male and two is female. So okay, so there's one more point. When you are going to have the categorical variables, now it is important that you also mention the categories. So here I'll just do it once again for you. When you see the values, right, and the values for gender in the questionnaire, you have given two options, and the option was value was given as one and it was written as male. At value was given as two and it was written as female. You at and then okay. So that is important, otherwise that will not appear in your result sheet. Over here, value as one, you give the name of the brand. So this is how spaces will differentiate between a categorical variable and a numerical variable. You will see above, that is for price, weight and all, we have not given these values. We have just kept it open. So, okay, so one is done. So two, I'll put it as L. Add three, I'll put it as Samsung. And four, I'll press Apple. Okay, so I'll just keep this. Okay. So I have prepared this categorical variables by adding the categories. Now coming to the data view, I just randomly, okay, entering. I'll do it for again 25 people or the respondents. So I have entered some random data, and now I will go on to the analyze. So I analyze, I go into this script because I want to do the chi-square test. So chi-square test, where it is available, it is available on the analyze, descriptive statistics, cross steps, and here I select one of the variable under investigation as row and the other one as the column. That sequence doesn't matter much. Okay, so it's irrespective of whether you select row as the brand and column as the gender, it is not going to make much difference. So I come to statistic, and you will find that chi-square is listed over here, and then I continue, and then I say okay. So here you have got the output. So basically this is the details about, like, say the cross tabulation or the matrix, like how many male, 14 male were there in a study, 11 female were there, total 25. And you see that four of the male out of 14, they preferred HP, nine preferred Dell, one preferred Samsung, and so on. Okay, so it gives the details. Now, what is interesting for us is this particular table. Okay, and here, not this entire table is important for us, just this value of significance, two tilde. So this is what is the value. So I was not interested in this likelihood criteria test. I was not interested in this linear by linear association test. What I was interested was in the Pearson chi-square. And here the value is coming to as zero. Okay, so now in any test which we're going to conduct now henceforth, we will be seeing this value of significance. Okay, now it is coming in this case as equal to zero. Okay, now I'll tell you how to interpret that particular value. So now any test we are going to conduct in future, we are going to take this particular value. So I'll just again stop the sharing and go on to my PowerPoint to tell you like how to interpret that particular value. So coming to the PowerPoint. Burgesh, seen?
No, sir, just a minute, sir. Yes.
Okay. Yes, sir. Okay. Okay, so now over here. So now, as I told you, like the SPSS software is going to give the value of significance. And in this case, we got it as equal to 0.00. Now, the interpretation of this is going to be important because there's something called as hypothesis, which we are required to test. And there's something called as null hypothesis and alternate hypothesis. Now, we'll not go into very much details of this because it's not required. Okay, for us, what is required is a very simple understanding. Okay, and that understanding is like our outcome. So here we call it as independent, and here we call it as dependent. We need not go into statistics of like writing a hypothesis as per the chi-square, which maybe you have seen in the statistical textbooks and so on. We are not statisticians now. We are just like doing research, and for us, like say, just understanding how to interpret is very important. Now, in simple, H naught is always going to be independent, and H1 is always going to be dependent. Now, what is that independent and dependent? So this is the two variables under question. Okay, so now here we had one variable as the brand preference, and the other variable was the gender. Now, independent means that the brand preference is independent of the gender. It means that if you are a male or a female, doesn't matter, or it is not going to have effect on this brand. Okay, so male also would select Samsung, and female also would select a Samsung. Or like say, selection of Dell is not dependent on whether he is a male or a female. And dependent means like the brand selection or the preference is going to be dependent on whether he is a male and he is a, or she is a female. Now we have to just keep this much in our mind, nothing else. Okay, now coming to this interpretation, if the significance value is less than 5% or 0.05, okay, then we say reject H naught. It means that H1 is accepted. Okay, so just writing in both the ways, I'll just avoid the confusion over here. Okay, so here I'll say H1 accepted. If this value is less than 0.05. If this value is more than 0.05, H naught accepted. So here in our study, the value is 0.00, which is less than 5%. It means that we're going to accept H1. What does that mean? It means that the selection of a laptop, it depends on whether it's a male or a female. So it means that the male likes a particular type of brand or the female likes a particular type of brand. So our study is saying that the selection of the laptop is dependent on whether it's a male or a female. Okay, so this is the chi-square test. And to get more information about that, because now one thing is very sure, that we have come to know that the brand selection depends on whether it's a male or a female. So let's go back to SPSS. I'm again sharing the screen. So let's have a look at the finding. So coming back to this particular thing, so already we come to know that it's whether the male or the female that makes a difference. So let's go back to this table, the gender brand cross tabulation, and now you can pay attention onto this. So you can see the females, they are more purchasing Samsung or the Apple, whereas the male, they are inclined more onto HP or Dell. So this is how. Okay, so looking at the table, it was difficult for us to tell, but now we have statistically tested it, right? And then from this test, we come to know that is the brand selection is going to be dependent on the gender. So this is how we do the chi-square test. Okay, Now I again stop the sharing. Okay, there's a lot of toggling you have to do. No issues. I will come back to this over here. Murugesh, seen?
Yes, sir. You're visible, sir.
Okay, the screen. Okay. So now coming back over here. So we have done this mean. We have done this chi square. So let us do maybe regression. We can do. Okay, and the regression is age and satisfaction. Both are numeric. Okay, so now here I have one more objective number 4, to study or investigate satisfaction towards laptop, and I want to make it more interesting again. So I'll say that okay, satisfaction and age are related. Age and satisfaction. So I say that satisfaction is related to age, but I can't, I have to just check it, evaluate it. Okay. So again, over here, I can say I have H naught and I have H1. So H naught is independent and H1 is dependent. I have to see in the object two. How many variables I have? I have 2 variables again. Satisfaction. Okay, but then I want to make it more interesting. Therefore, I would like to add age. So, to investigate satisfaction towards laptop is dependent on age, is my objective. Age is my other variable. Because I want to use regression. Okay, so it is very important that while you are framing the objectives, that time only you decide whether you will be using regression or not, because that will help you for, like, say, to develop the questionnaire also, and also to perform the test. Okay, so now here I want to use regression. So regression means I have to have both the variables as numerical. So satisfaction, okay, I am going to use a scale 1 to 5. And age, I'm just going to ask straightforward, what is your age? So that becomes numerical. So I now go back to spaces and show you how it's to be done. So again, I'm sharing the screen for spaces. Murugesh, screen seen?
Not it, sir.
It. Just let me know when the screen appears.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Visible.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So again, I come to the variable view, because it's very important for me to create the variables. I'll create age. Age, and I'll create satisfaction. Okay. I go to the data view, and here I just type the age. Okay, so it is numerical, so I have to put in the numerical data. So these are the age of my respondents. So don't relate it to the actual findings, because I'm just putting some random values. Okay, and sorry, coming to the satisfaction, I'm just putting some scores now. So it's a scale of 1 to 5. So the value has to be in between 1 and 5. Okay, so I have entered the information. Now I'll run the test, analyze. I want to run regression and linear, and I go on to selecting the variables. So you see that there is a dependent variable and there is a independent variable. Okay, so what is dependent? Is the age dependent on the satisfaction, or the satisfaction dependent on the age? So here the satisfaction is going to be dependent on the age. So the dependent variable is satisfaction, and age is going to be the independent. You can have other independent variables also added over here. If you like want to say that the satisfaction of the laptop is going to be dependent on the age, or even the price, or the weight, or the screen size, the battery, you can enter whatever you want to enter over here. But the only rule is that it has to be numerical data. You can't enter gender over here. Okay, so that's care you have to take. And I just click OK. That's it. Okay, and you get the values. So again, the important thing is that, like, say, I'll take a snapshot of this particular screen. I take a photo of the screen so that I remember these values. So again, if you see that there's a table called as coefficients. Now, regression is basically going to be an equation, y is equal to a plus bx. Okay, so here you see that that is a constant, that is a, and this is the coefficient of age. Now, age, it is coming as negative, like 0.056. So negative value here means, like, say, the relationship is inverse, in the sense, like, as the age increases, the satisfaction level decreases. So that is the finding what we're going to get over here. As the age increases, the satisfaction level decreases. Likewise over here, the model, it's a, how good is it's a model? Okay, so here it's again coming as significance, as equal to zero. So I'll just use these two values. I'll come back to your main screen in PPT, and then also we'll use this value of R square, which is 0.593. And I'll just interpret these three values, then maybe we take a call on summarizing this entire session. Okay, so I'll move on to the PowerPoint. I'll just stop this screen. So just before I move on to your PowerPoint, these values we have to keep in mind. Minus 0.056, significance 0, and R square is 0.593. So with these three values, I go back to your PowerPoint screen so that I show you the interpretation. Murugesh Sin,
sir.
Yeah, so here we come on to the interpretation. So I'll just write down these values. So the coefficient of age was coming as 0.056, and R square was coming as 0.593, and significance was coming as 0.00. So let us take the interpretation of this. So again, H0 and H1, that's very much important. So here it is independent, and here this is dependent. Okay, so now depending upon this value of significance, so what we do, we are going to, so this is less than 0.05, we accept H1. Now what is H1? H1 means it is dependent. It means that satisfaction is dependent on age. Next, okay, this is done. Then the type of relationship. So that will be taken from this value. Minus 0.056. It means that as the age increases, the satisfaction decreases. So more the age, less the satisfaction. Okay, so that is from this symbol involved in this coefficient of age, and this is the magnitude 0.056 on that scale of 1 to 5. It means that if the age increased by 1 year, the satisfaction drops by 0.056 on a scale of 1 to 5. Use that way. So age unit is here. So as the age increases by 1 year.
Sir, excuse me, sir.
Yes?
I think there is one by Mr. Muresh Mutt.
Hello? Hello?
Sir, the regression which you are using, he says in the message box, you can say that, sir.
It's a linear regression.
Sir, he says that, you know, there is some regression method was wrong.
No, it is regression only I have used.
Okay, he says regression is only when dependent and independent, both are numeric variables.
Yeah, so both are numeric in this case.
But he is a
Mr. We'll take that question. We'll take that question.
Okay,
in this case, both are numerical. Okay. Satisfaction is on a scale of 1 to 5.
Okay, sir.
And the other one was age is also numerical. That is.
Okay, sir.
Okay. Actually, Murugesh, what happens is that there's a lot of confusion when it comes to the ordinal scale and the interval scale.
Sir.
Okay. So I'll come to that.
Sir. Okay.
I'll come to that. I'll not leave it unanswered. I'll surely answer this particular question.
Please.
Anyway, with this we finish this particular regression, and then we come to know very interesting insights from this test. Okay. So Murugesh, maybe we have already crossed the time. So what is the instruction for me? Is it that I should continue further or I should stop over here?
Excuse me, sir.
Yes.
Sir, R square interpretation we have to do because we have already interpreted both.
R square I have not done. Okay, fine. Theek hai.
Yes.
Now R square interpretation we have to do. And R square is basically like, say, this value is going to range between 0 to 1. Okay, because it's a positive value, is going to be always positive. So it's 0 to 1. Now, what we can do is that this R square value, we can interpret in terms of the strength of the association. For that, I will like to add in some more input. Give me escape. I'll move on to the next slide. Okay, here. So for R square, because I'll just like to 0.9 was the value. Okay, fine. Sorry, it was 59, not 59. Okay. Or I can say 59%. Madam, let's take an example. Okay, so it's about satisfaction. And we say that satisfaction is dependent on age, price, and also one more variable. I like to add service. Now, this all I have taken on numerical. This is numeric, and this also is numeric. Right? Now, the regression is basically this value of coefficient. So when you're going to run it for these variables, so I'm going to get the coefficient value for age, which I had got it as 0.05 something. For price, I will get it as 0.1, and here I may get it as 0.22. Okay, so when you're going to add more number of independent variables, you're going to get this value. So age was minus. So the interpretation here is that this is basically called as regression analysis. The interpretation in the regression analysis is that, like, say, it's going to give you the coefficients, and based on these coefficients, the signs and the magnitude, we come to know, like, say, each of these independent variable, what impact it has on the satisfaction. So here, age is negative 0.05. So it means that as the age increases, satisfaction decreases. So price, based on price. So price, if I'm more satisfied, the satisfaction also is going to improve. Whereas the good, the service, the satisfaction is also going to be improving. So service improves, satisfaction improves. The price, basically, I'm satisfied with the price. The satisfaction of the price is, or the importance that I attach to the price is on a higher side. The satisfaction also is on a higher side. Whereas more the age, drop in the satisfaction. So this is what I'm going to get out of regression analysis. Now, there's one more test called as correlation. Okay. So the difference between regression and correlation is, like, in regression, I do individual analysis. Age with satisfaction, price with satisfaction, service with satisfaction. That is what we have just done it over here. But in correlation, right, if the manager of a laptop company wants to use this as a model to predict the satisfaction of employees. Okay, so when I say model, this entire model, can he use this entire model, which comprises these three variables, as a model to predict the customer satisfaction? Okay, whether really it is statistically significant or not. So basically it is dependency or it is independency. Okay, so how good is this model? So as I told you, like, say the significance, what I have, just a minute. Okay, so how good is this model? How good is this model, whether the company can use it or not? So that can be spoken on the basis of this R square value and this significance value. Now, the significance value is coming as 0.00. It means that statistically this model is talking about dependency because it is except H1. Okay. And to what extent this bonding is strong? So this bonding is strong up to an extent of 59%. It means that these three variables, independent variables, okay, is bonded with this satisfaction, and the strength of the bonding is 59%. So the strength of the bonding and the significance are going to be, like, somewhat related to each other. If the significance is usually when it is going to come as less than 5%, the R square value is usually going to be above 50%. So any values, so it's basically, again, a rule of thumb which we are going to use over here for correlation, okay, upon the basis of R square. So when R square value is less than, like, say 20%, we call it as low correlation. Okay, from 20% to 50%, okay, we call it as, like, say somewhat moderate. Okay, above 50% to 70%, we call it as high, and above 70%, we call it as strong, and if it's going to be one, we're going to call it as perfect. So over here, it is coming in the high category. So basically what we're trying to say is that this model is good enough. Okay, so you, when you're going to do the study, you did not focus much on this R square value. Okay, you can just focus on this significance value. If the significance value is coming less than 0.05 or 5%, you can straight away, without referring this particular R square value, can say that your model is pointing towards dependency. That is, the satisfaction is dependent on age, price, and service. So this is how it has to be interpreted. Murugesh, instructions?
Sir, there are some, one more question is coming from Jyoti Dikshit. We are just working on variables in the factors. We are not used factor analysis anywhere.
Okay. So you can surely use it. Yeah.
Sir.
Maybe if anyone has the questions, they can directly put it to me. They can come on the voice, and if it's possible, that
yes,
we can.
Sir. Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Can I ask?
Madam.
Yeah, this is Jyoti Dikshit. Sir, I was your student actually in NITI. Sir, sir, we are just using the variables. We are running regression analysis, chi-square test on variables. But in the beginning, you had taught us that we can do factor analysis. So where to use that factor analysis in
only in case, like, say, if you have an objective. Only in case when there is a need, actually, okay, for you to, like, say, reduce these dimensions? Like, say, how many variables you have? Like, what's your strategy, Jyoti?
Just now you had taught that you had 12 variables and we had done 3 factors. We had
I know, I understand that. How many variables you have in your study and what is the study all about?
No, sir, my study is different. I just want to, I'm doing secondary analysis. So mine is entirely different.
Yeah. So yes, so when the objective demands that you should reduce the variables, right? So basically whenever you have gone for any exploratory study, and from the exploratory studies, whenever you have identified variables and the variables are huge in number, large in number, it is better for you to give some meaning to those variables by clubbing them in some groups. So that will be more meaningful and easy for interpretation to the others. So it's basically like, say, to add in more amount of, convenience and reducing the complexity of, like, say, going through 30 or 40 variables or 50 variables. So it is always better, like, say, if you are just presenting those 40 or 50 variables, or even if it's going to be 20 or 25 variables in smaller dimensions. So that is going to be easy for even you as a researcher to interpret and for also the others to understand that.
Sir, here, can you call out one research objective based on factor analysis? You just can call out.
Yeah, so I can, for example, now we talk about factors, okay? We take example of an HR, human resources area. So we have an employee, right? So employees have to be, satisfied. Now I just want to know what are these factors which leads to satisfaction. So now I go to different companies, I start interacting with the employees, and I just ask them to list down the factors. Okay, so now they start listing on the factors. So there, someone says salary, someone says increments, okay, someone says bonus, someone says health checkup, okay, someone says free medicine, okay, someone says breaks, someone says free lunch, what about someone says education for my child. You got to know, like, when we're exploring this, so like it is happening that there are many number of variables which will be coming. Like, say, if I just go on listing all these variables, so it may happen that there will be some 80 variables in all, like, say, which the employees are going to ask for. Now for me, it is difficult to write down 80 variables and also comment on all these 80 variables. So can I, like, say, come out with some blocks or some dimensions in which these 80 variables can be classified? What the point? So, like, say, here it could be children welfare measures, like free education for the children, free bus transport for the children to go to school and come back, free coaching. What a point? So this is how it is going to be added. So those variables from here, it will be added over here. Variables pertaining to salary increments, bonuses, okay, timely promotions. So this could be, like, say, the professional measures, right? So likewise, there could be some other conditions, like, say, safe drink or fresh drinking water, and pre-medical checkup, or good lighting, good ventilation. So that is what he is going to look at in the factory. So this could be the working conditions. Got a point? So these 80 variables can be come out with this particular specific.
So, sir, categories. Can we have one objective on one factor? Is it like what the satisfaction level, like children welfare schemes or working condition? So on these factors, we can have one objective each, right? Is it?
No, your objective was to explore these factors, no?
Okay.
You have explored it. Got a point? Because you are not knowing this before. Now you have explored from your study. Now it is known to you. So your objective was to know this, right? So the objective was only one. The objective was to explore the employee satisfaction factors. So that was your objective.
But where to use it then, sir? How to use it in output?
Output means what? So this is what is a finding, na?
Okay, we are just stating.
Because this is exploratory, I told you, right? In exploratory studies, it's basically you're exploring.
Okay.
So it's explored, done. That is the objective, because this was not known before, these groups.
Okay.
And these findings you can compare with the other research studies, like your factors, like these dimensions and the other dimensions in the other studies, whether they are same or they are different. Okay, so next question we can take.
Murgesh Bhatt.
Yes.
Murgesh Bhatt, please come online. You can ask your question. I think he has written his question in the
chat box. Okay.
Yes, sir.
I'll just try to read it. Okay. Satisfaction is category. So regression and okay. Satisfaction is category means dependent variable is category. Should I? Okay, I got that question. Okay, fine. Okay. So this is about the categorical variable and this is about the numerical variable. Okay. So in regression, I had used satisfaction and I told that it is a scale of 1 to 5. Okay. So now the question is pertaining to this, I believe, because he says that satisfaction, how it can become a numerical when I'm giving a range from 1 to 5. So let me give you more information on this. So it is like, say, in categorical, we're going to have different types. Again, I have not gone into details of that. So we have nominal, we have ordinal, and over here we have interval and we have ratio. I'll just quickly tell about this. Nominal means like, say, nominal. It's like, say, we have used the brand preference. I have given 1, 2, 3, and 4. So I have given HP, I have given Dell, I have given X, Y. Okay, so you have to tick just one. So this is nominal. Now, ordinal is that we have used one more age group. And in age group also, we had given the options 1, 2, 3, and 4. So in age group, we had said like, say, less than 30, 30 to 40, 40 to 60, 60 and above. Right? So here also, we are required to tick one, whichever is applicable. But then there's a difference between these both questions. Okay, in age group, you will see that it is in an increasing order. The order is there. Okay, like age is increasing 30 to 60. So therefore, this will be example of ordinal, whereas this is an example of nominal. Now, I'll use one more example of ordinal and I'll make it as satisfaction. Okay, 1, 2, 3, and 4. I'll say not at all satisfied, somewhat satisfied, satisfied, highly satisfied. Now here again, it is an ordinal, you can see it here, and here again it is an order of increasing satisfaction. Okay, so it becomes ordinal. Now ordinal is an example of categorical. Okay, now this is different from this, the scale what we had used before. The scale what we have used before is a numerical scale, and it's more specifically an interval scale. Okay, so I'll just again use it. I'll just show the difference once again. So satisfaction and satisfaction. So here it is interval, here it is categorical. So satisfaction in an interval scale, I have used your level of satisfaction from 1 to 5, where 1 is not at all satisfied and 5 is highly satisfied. Over here, okay, we have used it as option. Okay, like not at all satisfied or somewhat satisfied or highly satisfied or very, very satisfied. So this is 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. Now there is a difference over here. Okay, because when I'm going to tell the respondent that give a satisfaction on a scale of 1 to 5, where 1 is not satisfied and 5 is satisfied, on this scale, he can give me any value. He can give me 1.1, he can give me 2.5, he can give me 3.6, he can give me 4.7, he can give me 4.9, he can give me 5. So this is just like your measurement scale, the scale which you use to measure the length, right? So it is just like your measurement scale with the extreme size 1 and 5. But here, when I'm going to ask in this fashion, okay, he has to either tick 1 or 2 or 3 or 4 or 5. So this becomes a categorical. Now for the regression, we used this interval type. We had not used this type. Okay, and the researchers, usually we do a mistake. So this categorical is called as ordinal. Okay, what mistake we do in our research is that when we do the research, we usually use a categorical scale. But when we do the analysis, okay, we do the analysis which is applicable to the interval scale. Because we know that mean cannot be applied onto this categorical scale. I showed you the example of the gender. Okay, because if I get a mean of 3.4, how do I interpret it? There's no category for me as 3.4. It's either satisfied or highly satisfied. I can't say, I can't imagine new category depending upon the values. Okay, so it is not appropriate for me to use mean. And regression is a test which is going to be based on mean and standard deviation. So I'll be just going out with this interval scale when I just give the extremes. Okay, I'll make it an interval scale. I'll not make it an ordinal scale, which is a categorical scale. Hope you have, hope maybe I am able to clear a doubt. Murugesh, Matt. Professor Murugesh, next question.
Hello. Sir.
Yes. Hello. Yes. Yes, ma'am.
My sound is audible, sir.
Yes, audible. Yes,
audible. Hello.
Yes, Murugesh.
Ah, sir. Sir, the thing is, the satisfaction level actually is a categorical, sir. Hello.
Huh?
The satisfaction level, sir, that was categorical, sir.
No, in my example, I used 1 to 5. It's about the scale, how you put the scale in a questionnaire.
Sir, even though you have given the scale, the original was categorical only.
You're talking in the SPSS? In the SPSS?
Not SPSS, sir. Numerically, you are just converting the categorical into numerical. But the real
No. I told you, not me. The researchers will convert it. Okay, yeah, so ordinal scale. Okay, so Murugesh, what I'll request you is that you take any good book on research methodology, okay, and you read the difference between ordinal scale and the interval scale. So you will get to know yourself, okay? So the explanation what I wanted to give. Yes?
Continuous variable, sir.
Which one? Yeah, the interval scale is a continuous variable. Interval scale is a continuous variable.
Ordinal. You are giving.
Ordinal is a categorical variable. It's an ordinal variable.
Yes, sir, categorical, sir. Because the
ordinal is categorical, yes, I agree with you.
Yes, sir, nominal, whatever the
nominal is categorical.
Yeah, categorical. Then the satisfaction level is categorical, sir. Dependent variable is.
That's what I'm telling you, Murugesh. It depends on how you're going to use it. If you're going to use it in this fashion, it becomes categorical. If you're going to use it in this fashion, it becomes interval. So therefore, I'm requesting you to read more on the interval scale and the ordinal scale. Okay, you're confusing yourself because it's a mistake that I told you. It's a mistake we researchers do is that in our research questionnaire, we put it as a ordinal scale, but then we apply the test of treating it as an interval scale. Which is wrong.
Level is not interval scale, sir. It is ordinal scale.
Arey Baba, main kya bol raha hu tumko? Any scale you can make it to categorical or interval. It's your choice.
Yeah,
okay?
Categorical, sir. My question is categorical.
Okay, you can make it categorical, but if you are making it categorical, please don't use regression. Okay, you may be caught by examiner. Okay?
Yes, sir. Because satisfaction level 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, these are categories.
I am telling that only, na? I am telling you that only. Here I have used category 1, 2, 3, 4. Here I have used category 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Here I have not used category. I have just used 1 and 5. Got a point? I have not given the between categories.
1 to pi you are using, but usually that is not numerical, it is categorical.
Okay, got it.
Yes, sir. Regression, when we use both dependent and independent variable are categorical.
Okay. Categorical?
No, sir. Both are numerical. Then only we go for that.
I used that only before.
No, sir. The satisfaction level is categorical and the another one is numerical.
So okay, I change. Okay. I change it according to you. But for the class, it is up to you. Okay, so how you are going to differentiate between the categorical variable and the numerical variable? So as I'm showing you to showing for all the class over here. So you should. Okay, Murugesh, you got the point. Okay, and all the others also have got the point. But for the audience and the participants,
we have to.
Okay. So for the okay, got it. Okay, so okay, ordinal logistics is different again. Okay, in that case, I have to have the ordinal variables. But then here in this case,
when dependent variable more than two categories, then we will go for ordinal logistic regression.
Yes, we have many categories. We have ordinary. We have binary logistics regression. Okay, there are 10 different. Okay, there are 10 different types of regressions which we can use. Okay, but that's not the purpose of this thing.
But this was
the purpose is that. Okay, Murugesh, we got it. I'm not denying you. Okay, but then still I request you to read the different types of scales. Okay.
Yes, sir.
Because it's up to you which satisfaction you can make it interval scale. Satisfaction you can make it the categorical.
Even though interval scale is a continuous variable, but just you are
Okay, Murugesh. Okay, Murugesh, I'll do one exercise.
Please.
Murugesh. Okay. Murugesh, I will do an exercise for you. Murugesh Mutt, I will do an exercise for you. Okay. Murugesh, you are a teacher or you are a student?
Yeah, no, sir. Teacher.
Teacher. Okay, Murugesh. Okay. Teacher, you are a Murugesh, you are a teacher, right? Murugesh, there is a scale 1 to 5. I am giving it to you, okay? Yes, and this I am telling, this is not at all satisfied. And this is highly satisfied.
Yes, sir. Okay. The category only you are given numerical. 1, 2, 5.
Okay. Wait. Listen to my example. I'm doing a survey here. Murugesh, you are a teacher. Okay. And you have been working in this particular field for how many years?
Sir, just I completed a degree.
Okay, good, Murugesh. So currently you're working. So how satisfied you are with your job?
Highly satisfied.
On this scale?
What's a 5?
5?
Sir, the thing is, you are
just... No, just give me an answer. Highly satisfied 5, right? See, when you give the answer... Pardon?
Hello?
Yes?
Yes, sir. The thing is not issue, sir. You are categorical. Just you are giving them 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. But the usual original is a categorical. So that's why the case is not regression. That's all my points, sir.
Okay, theek. I'll go with the point. I'll not spend much time on this.
Yes, sir.
Okay, so but then for the audience and for the researchers and others, so you have to keep in mind that we have two types. We have interval and we have ordinal. In ordinal, I'm going to give the options like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and that is going to restrict, okay, myself. So I can only take 1, 2, 3, 4, or 5, and in the interval scale, I am going to give a scale, which is a measurement scale, 1, 2, 5, and here I'm not going to give any options. I've just told about the extreme points, and you're going to give me some value in between this, and this value can be any integer value. It can be 1.5, 2.5, 3.5, 4.5, and so on. And any variable, okay, it might be satisfaction variable, it can be the importance attached variable, okay, it can be a perception variable. So any scale can be asked in these two format, even satisfaction. Okay, now when you have used satisfaction. So, okay, Murugesh is fine. I'm summarizing it up. Okay, so your knowledge, we have shared it, and it is okay. I'm just concluding. So, for any satisfaction scale, when you have used in a format of the interval scale, okay, it can assume any value. It can get any value. Okay, like 1.5, 2.5, 3.5, and in this case, it will be treated as a numerical. And when you are restricted to just 4 or 5 options, in that case, it will be restricted to categorical. Okay, and in India, what we see, what we see in India is that, like say, researchers don't differentiate between this numerical and categorical variable when we are using a scale. Okay. And this information, you can get it on different types of scale. And for that, I request you once again that maybe this knowledge can be enhanced on learning more on the interval scale and the ordinal scale. Now, before I sum up again, I'll just again like to come back to this main sheet which we had developed. So similarly, based on what type of variables you have, okay, you can go with this particular combination and you can go with the different test. The only thing is that because we have less shortage of time, you can make use of Google. And now, anyway, you have I have told you like say when to use a 2-sample t-test. So when you go to Google, just type 2-sample t-test, and then just follow the steps. But then here the example I have given, one numerical and one categorical. So here again, this numerical we're treating satisfaction, and categorical we're taking it as the gender. So here again, you can always go with this test, 2-sample t-test. And it's important for us to understand that, like say, I'm using 2-sample t-test. Why? Because this gender has just 2 options, male and female. Whereas when I'm talking about the occupation, the gender has more options, like businessmen, professionals, housewives, students, and so on. So it's going to have more than 2 options. So that it can be taken as ANOVA.
Hello.
Okay, Murgesh, I am through.
Sir, here also in the fifth, numerical and categorical, you are telling us. Here also, satisfaction level also is categorical, sir.
Both. Okay. Theek hai.
Occupation and satisfaction.
Okay.
There is one more query from Sunil. Sir, can you explain about the sample selection? Is we need to select sample on the basis of total population? If population is infinite, how we can select sample?
This question is from whom?
This question is from Mr. Sunil.
Okay, Sunil. Actually, like say, it requires some going into the details of your population, and for that, will be required to have a population size. Okay. So that usually was a old-styled type of selecting the sample size, okay? But now, what you can do is that to be on the safer side. Okay, so nowadays we find that these type of calculations are not included in your research and not also included in your thesis. And no one asked for this particular information, like what has been your population, the population size, and what is the error scope, and what type of error scope you would like to have in terms of the sampling error, in terms of the measurement error and all. So those details will be required. I'll be not able to tell you over here in this particular session, but then I'll still give you one simple tool through which you can
Sir, your voice is not audible, sir. Hello.
Yeah, it's audible now, Murgesh?
Yes, sir.
Okay, take it. Okay, so now, as I told, I was just telling that it's a procedure, like say, which requires a lot of information. Information in terms of, like say, you knowing the population size, that's capital N, and you knowing the information pertaining to the sampling errors and the measurement errors. Okay, so that's the confidence at which you would be required to conduct your study. But then that becomes the traditional, the conventional way of arriving at the sample sizes, and it's not practical or it's not feasible. Okay, because sometimes what happened that the sample size N, what you are going to calculate, okay? So it might come to like say 6,000. The formula may give you a sample size which is of 6,000, and that is going to be dependent on your population size of like say 2 lakh. Okay, so this reaching this 6,000 is just not feasible. And then what we feel is that, like, say, when I go through the different reports, the thesis report and the different research papers, when I'm going to review it. Okay, so it is just for the purpose of giving this value is, or this formula is given. But then actually we see that in the study, the sample size is taken as 600 or maybe maximum 700. Okay, because it is time consuming and as well as it is costly. So nowadays the trend or the style is, like, say, when you're going to justify your sample size, we are not justifying it with the use of the sample size calculation formula. Okay, what way we are going to justify is that, like, say, you see from the review of literature, the similar studies which have been conducted. Okay, like, say, for example, when I'm going to conduct a study on blockchain technology, okay, blockchain technology adoption in industries. So what I go, what I do is that, like, say, I want to do a survey and then see, like, say, to what extent blockchain technology is adopted in the industries. So what I do is that I review the previous studies which have been conducted on these new emerging technologies, and I make a note of the sample sizes based in these previous studies or used in these previous studies. Like, say, there are some 4 or 5 sample studies of previous papers which has done studies on the blockchain technology. So here they have taken n is equal to 200, here they have taken n is equal to 300, here they have taken n is equal to 400, here they have taken n is equal to 250, and so on. Okay, so what I do is that I keep this as a reference and then say that my sample size would be roughly around 350. Okay, and I say that the sample size selected for this study is 350. Okay, as this is what is the sample size selected in similar studies conducted previously, and in the bracket you write the source of the studies, like, say, Sharma 2018, okay, Verma 2020, okay, then one more study or two more studies, whichever are there. So you just quote them. This is just sufficient. Okay, because the reviewer who is going to review your paper or a thesis, he will get an idea. Yes, this is what is the range. But upon, and there's one more practical support which you will get to this type of justifications. And that is, like, say, blockchain technology is a new emerging technology, which is not implemented in all the industries. It's just very few people who have started implementing it. So you, when you have used this particular formula, and then even if you are going to get, like, say, something like 1,000, there may be no 1,000 companies who already might have implemented this blockchain technology, right? So this way, it's like, say, better to give justification in this particular format. But then, yes, surely, if you want to have more details on the sample size calculation formula, that I will take it maybe whenever we are going to meet next time. Or maybe you can also separately write a mail to me. I will send you the literature which I have with me, and I will share with you for sure.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Okay.
Yes.
Thank you very much, sir. I think the session was wonderful, and most of the queries have been handled.
Yeah, so I have made a new friend also in Murgesh Math today.
Okay. I understand, sir. And the session was wonderful. I think I regret for the inconvenience in between.
It got disconnected, but it was not your fault. It is not even my fault. It's about the technology, and that's about me getting used to this technology. In fact, like, say, I should have kept my mobile phone on so that I could have immediately looked at your calls. But then, because I didn't want calls disturbing our session, I just wanted to, like, say, keep it off. So anyways, still you could reach me and then we could come on track. Otherwise, it would have been difficult.
Sir, thank you very much, sir. Now, I would like to request Professor Yama Shulapur, sir, to kindly give a moderation opinion.
Shulapur, sir, good morning, good afternoon.
Good morning, Dr. Sachin.
Yeah, good morning, everyone. Yeah, we have been trying to meet since long, actually. I interact, right?
Yeah. So in 1997-99, we had a good time in Kausal Institute for seen you there. And I kept on just, observing the kind of the academic progress you have been doing. So excellent, Dr. Sachin, to see you. And I could also see some of your papers, which have been collaborated with one of the top class, researchers in the world. Congratulations to you, Dr. Sachin, so much. Thank you very much. And in fact, the session was very, very insightful. You, for every explanation, you gave the example. You started with a decision on buying the laptops, what are the various factors. And each objective you supported with the appropriate data. One of the important takeaways, which I think is useful for every researcher, is quite often as a research guide and as a researcher, we come across confusion regarding the variable and the kind of the test to be adopted. You gave a very convincing picture about under each kind of a variable, what is the appropriate test to be chosen. For example, if it is categorical, percentage or frequency, and if it is numerical, it is a mean. If it is categorical only, then chi-square test, numerical and numerical regression analysis. It's a wonderful, wonderful takeaway for every researcher. And you could also, take us through the process of, the regression, the strength of the association, regression versus correlation, ANOVA, so on and so forth. Dr. Sachin, I'm very much happy to have listened to such a wonderful session. And I could also find that there were some feedbacks from the participants saying wonderful, and some said informative. And there were also, some questions from the participants on factor analysis and the sample size calculation. It was very wonderfully answered by you, Dr. Sachin. So nice to see you. And in fact, from my end, there were some technical problems. So I missed some of the important points which you are sharing. And I must also thank Professor Bagali and Dr. Murugesh for having taken a lead to organize this useful webinar. Dr. Sachin, once again, thank you very much. Nice to see you.
Yes, sir. Thank you. My pleasure, sir.
And thanks to all the participants, and thanks to, I don't have appropriate words how to express my happiness to see Dr. Sachin and listen to his wonderful presentation. Thank you, Dr. Sachin. Thanks to Professor Principal Bagali. Thanks to Dr. Murugesh and entire team of BLD Commerce College and the management. Thank you all. Over to Sachin and Dr. Murugesh.
Thanks a lot, sir. And I request all the participants to come online with the video mode so you can capture some screen. So it will be a great for all of us.
Hello.
Now, thank you, Virendra Kumar Verma. Yes, Dr. Ashwini.
Hello.
Yes, thanks a lot. Most of the people are coming on. Thank you, Baliga, sir.
Hello.
Okay, sir, if you have anything to say, Madam Solapur, sir.
Hello.
Sir, please. Please mute yourself. Only video, please on the video. Only on the video. Okay. Dr. Chidananda, can you mute all? Now, without wasting much of time, I'll request Dr. R.V. Kulkarni, sir, managing person and administrative officer of BLD Association, to kindly give a presidential remark on this occasion. Over to Dr. R.V. Kulkarni.
Good afternoon. Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, I think there's some problem with my video. Okay. Good afternoon, one and all. At the outset, on behalf of BLD Association, we are grateful to Dr. Professor Sachin Kamble, who has delivered a wonderful lecture today. It was complete a classroom teaching. And just I was going through the chat messages also. There is very fantastic, wonderful feedback from all the participants. That is a great news for us. And some of the participants have also requested recordings of the today's session. Dr. Patanjali will do that and he will circulate. Thank you very much. And at the outset, I also thank the organizers for having organized this international webinar. Professor Bagli sir, principal of the institute. Professor Savita Kulkarni madam, director of the MBA program. Bharti Mutt madam, IQVC coordinator, and Professor Patan Shetty, event coordinator. It was a wonderful session. I could not attend it entire session, but however, I attended few part of the session. I am not a statistician. I am from pharmacy background, but the statistics plays a very important role in all the research and day-to-day activities. Its role is more in the economic and social development of the country as a whole. So I see statistics in four important domains: its role in evidence-based policy making, its role in planning, progress monitoring, and evaluation of the activities, its role in global monitoring, and as well as its role in developing and maintaining a reliable, up-to-date, and easy accessible database. So what so far we heard is applied statistics, because we all from health science background will apply statistics in every research. But today, Professor Sachin Kamble has gone into the details, and we have seen he used SPSS software, and earlier we used to do all the statistical work manually, but today number of tools are available for the statistics, and whether it is in vivo studies or in vitro studies, whether in vivo or in vitro correlation, we are lucky enough today we are having number of tools. So finally, I can say the session was very wonderful. And what always we say, the better data and better lives. So we have to make utilization, better utilization of the statistics, and by providing the reliable data. That is very important. If the data is misleading, then we should not blame the statistics as a whole. Thank you, sir. Thank you, and one and all. And again, I am thankful to Professor Sachin Kamble, sir, for your wonderful lecture. Thank you.
Thank you for your wonderful presentation remarks, sir. Now, over to Dr. Ashwini Arnold for a vote of thanks. Before giving it to Ashwini Arnold, it's a request to all participants. We are sending feedback link to in the same webinar group, and the link will be active today up to 5 o'clock only. So please make use of it and try to give a feedback link and get your certificates directly on your mail, and try to fill all the details correctly so that you know you can receive your certificates properly. Now over to Dr. Ashwini.
Good afternoon, all. As all good things come to an end, so is the webinar too. On behalf of the Pioneer Institute, BLD's Ace Patil College of Commerce, Autonomous, Vijayapura, I, Dr. Ashwini Anand, take this opportunity to propose a vote of thanks. I thank our today's resource person, Dr. Sachin Kamble. We are really enlightened with your rich knowledge, sir. Thank you, sir, for being with us. We are thankful to today's moderator, Dr. Emma Solapur, sir. Thank you, sir, for always being with us. I would like to thank our Chief Administrator Officer, Dr. Ari Kulkarni, for unconditional support. Thank you, sir. I thank our Principal, Sri V.S. Bagli, for his enthusiastic support. a special thanks to all the participants come over from different state of the India and other countries too. And Dr. Murgesh Pattanashetty, organizing committee, teaching, non-teaching staff, and all my students' friends for active participating and for their unflinching support and coordination. Thank you. Thank you one and all.
Hello, Murgesh. And okay, thank you all of you, and have a nice day, and I wish you all a very fruitful research career. And whenever you feel like you want to have input from me, any help required from my side, you can always reach to me on my Gmail ID, which I've shared in the chat box. I may be a little bit slow on replying, but then surely I'll be able to reply back to you. Okay, thank you. Thank you all. Thank you to the organizers. Thank you, Chidu. Bye-bye.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
Okay. Okay. I'll just log out now. Okay. Thank you, all of you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you, Verma, sir, for joining, and even Baliga, sir. There are so many people, you know, which I connect from.
Thank you so much, sir. It's a great session.
Yeah, it's been a long time, you know, we were, you know, working on that.
Sir, I will call you when you will free. I will call you,
please,
definitely.
Please. You are working on which area of research?
Sir, basically, I'm working additive manufacturing, 3D printing medical.
Okay.
For neurosurgery, for brain parts.
Okay.
Applying MCDM tools for this part. Okay. Basically, totally new area. I'm trying to AI plus MCDM tools.
Okay.
Yeah.
Even we will try to give the link as the professor Ganapati sir requested. Even Ganapati sir spoke to even Sachin sir.
He's great. Ganapati sir is very great.
You know, I'll tell you, Virendra sir, you know, during our time, you know, 2011,